One of the most important things about pain management is the assessment. If I don't know what we're treating, I can't treat it appropriately. So some of that comes in just finding out about the pain. Tell me about the pain. You know, what is it? What does it do to you? What's the impact of the pain? How does this feel? What makes it better? What makes it worse? What was your response to medication? You know, if a person comes in and says, I hated morphine, I didn't like morphine, I had all sorts of side effects to morphine, and then I write a prescription for morphine, they're going to say, well, doctor didn't listen to me, and why am I taking this stuff anyway? So it's important to say, okay, look, you had difficulties with morphine, I have other options here. In fact, I think this one is a much better option for you because you had these sort of side effects. Or, you know what, I think that maybe we don't even need morphine. We can start on this medication or that medication. Sometimes, and I've got a few patients like this, where they did not feel that they were told about the pain, and the pain becomes the center of their whole world. They become very angry. They don't deal well with the pain. The pain has an impact on family, social, you know, psychosocial as well. And those are really, I would say, the tougher sort of cases to deal with. And that's definitely where we bring into the, you know, bring other sort of disciplines into it. The psychosocial piece, we might need to look at the social work piece. We might need to look at, you know, even more than that, something like psychiatry if there's true mental health issues, person's depressed or beyond. So it's, I think that one has to be open to more than just got a pain, take a pill sort of thing. You look at more of that. And especially in the cancer patient, because cancer is a life-changing diagnosis. You know, even though people will live a life afterwards, their life is different than when it was before. There are patients who are good patients. They don't want you to, you know, they want to do what's best for what you want to hear. So when they come in and I say, how's your pain? And they say, it's good, it's fine. Yet on their pain score, they might have a 7. And I'll say, 7's pretty bad, isn't it? And, oh, no, that's fine. You know, they're trying to be a good patient, or they're trying not to upset the apple cart. They don't want to do other sorts of interventions. You know, they feel they're okay right now. Some of that comes through when I have the family there, and I think it's really important for a person to come in with family or with somebody else, because I'll say, have, you know, this very proper lady say, oh, everything's fine, and in the background you see the daughter going, you know, and it's kind of like, okay, tell me more about that. Let's hear about this. How is the pain affecting you? Are you spending more time in bed? You know, you find out that maybe they are spending 10 out of 15 waking hours in bed because they've got such terrible pain. Those other hours, those, you know, 3 or 4 are great, but, you know, they don't think about that because they're spending so much time there. So I think it's really important to look at that. And you know, that's one of those patient barriers that comes up when we're starting to talk about pain control or any sort of symptom control. That's that good patient. And I think it's, from a professional point of view, it's kind of satisfying. You've got a patient that's doing all the right things and everything looks good. But there are certain patterns that I look for. You know, patients who don't complain or they minimize all their symptoms. No one can have no symptoms all the time. Or people who have all the symptoms all at a 10, I get worried about that too, because that means there's more than just the pain going on, and you have to tease that out. So a lot of that, some of it is the art of medicine. I mean, there's definitely a science, but there's also that feeling you go in there and your gut instinct tells you something's not right here. When we're dealing with pain, it's really important to engage both the patient and the family. The family is often the caregiver who's involved with that. When we're talking about it, it's really important to have that caregiver buy into whatever sort of process we're going to do. So if we're going to recommend opioids or morphine for the patient, we want to make sure that the family is also in agreement. Sometimes the patient says, yes, yes, I want this, and the family are going, oh my God, we're going to make a drug addict out of them. I don't want to deal with this. There's going to be morphine in my house. People will break in. Those are fears that you need to talk to people about. You need to address them. sometimes they won't say very much, and you have to say, what are your fears around this? What are your concerns around this? Sometimes people will say, well, I can't have morphine, and they're dead set against morphine. So I'll say, okay, I won't give you morphine, but I have some relatives of morphine that work pretty well. And for whatever reason, they're stuck on the morphine. If I say, I can give you hydromorphone, oh, good, that sounds good. You know, and yet they're getting the same medication in many ways, and we can still deal with the issues around that. So I think it's really important to find out what are the things that are getting in the way of them accepting these sort of medications. One of the professional barriers to things like pain control, I don't have the time. You know, we've got to talk about chemotherapy, the nausea, we have to talk about, you know, follow-up, all this sort of thing. And they say, I just don't have the time. I don't want to open that Pandora's box. And yet, you know, it truly does not take that much time. Just even addressing the patient's concerns. What are your concerns today? Well, I'm concerned about pain. Tell me more about the pain. Within 5 to 7 minutes, you can have a really good history. You can do the physical exam, the directed physical exam. You can start a medication. You can bring in someone else to help out with education, either a nurse clinician, or we have a pharmacist who does a lot of the education around medication. And if you look at it, you may have added 7 to 10 minutes to the entire time. That's all. And yet the patient feels that you've heard them. They may even say, well, you spent half an hour with me. And it's that perception that's really important. And even the perception of saying, tell me about, you know, starting to listen. There's lots of research that tells us that doctors do all the speaking when they're doing an interaction with the patient. And I think the patient has somewhere around 10 or 12 seconds to get their story out before we start interrupting them. And so, of course, they feel like nobody listens to them. So if you give them enough time, then you can get that story. You know, hearing their stories is probably the most important part of what we do.